Welcome, ECE 240. Here we are, week one, our introduction of our class. One of the things I really want to start with is I want to ensure that you are put in a position to succeed. And we're going to get a little bit more of what that means right now. But before we get into that, I want you to do three things for me. Get a piece of paper out really quick, a pen or a pencil. And I want you to write down, what do you want to learn in this class? Number two, what grade will you earn in this class? And number three, what goals do you have for your life? Just take the time really quick, write those down. Hopefully you fully engage with me. These videos are here to support your learning and to really enhance your ability to be successful this semester in our class. So take another minute just to write down what you want to learn, what grade you believe you will earn, and what goals do you have for your life? Or just a goal, write down one. Hopefully you have that written down. Let me tell you why. A, for your second question, I hope all of you put an A. We have to be in the business of putting ourselves in the best position to be successful. And how we do that is by believing in ourselves, giving ourselves the motivation, the opportunity, and the time to be successful. If you're okay with the B, okay with the C, I don't think employers want to hire a person who is content with average. We need to put yourself in a position to achieve. This is why you are here. Give yourself a pat on the back because you can be anywhere else. But no, you selected to enhance your capacity, to put yourself in a position to enhance your career, to give yourself the opportunity to gather all these keys that can open up more doors. So I want to start with you. Always motivate, always start with yourself that you can succeed, that you have the potential and opportunity to achieve the greatest outcomes. Because once you have that deep down in you, and once you believe in that, you can pass that on to others. And that's huge. Let's not write down that I'm okay with the B. No. You're going to put yourself in a position to succeed. Because that's what employers are looking for. An individual that on their own has the stamina, has the dedication to support success. And we're going to start those habits in this class. These habits, these skills, if we start using them now, are easier to use later in life. One of the biggest gifts that we can give to ourselves is the power of relationships and understanding the benefits of having high quality relationships. It's important that we take the time to surround ourselves with good people, with people that want the best for us. People who challenge us, who motivate us. They don't let us just be a B or a C, but that push us to be that A. Those are the people that we want in our life. Those are the people that we want to be able to work with as well. But you have to take time to form these relationships. You got to take time to open yourself up and share your story. And that's what I'm going to do And that's what we're going to do this week. We're going to be storytellers this week. We're going to get to know each other this week. We're going to have the opportunity to share our story so that we can improve our relationships, so we can improve our time together, so we all can learn together. So this is what I want to do now, really quick. Let's get you out of this. And get you here. All right, let me open up this really quick. Awesome. I'm going to take the time to tell you my story before I get to learn about your story. This is how we're going to start to build our relationship together. Get to know a little bit about me. Share not all the just perfect or good things. There's no perfect, but share my story to you. Share everything. And have the opportunity to build that relationship, even though this class is 100% online. Part of what I'm going to do here is give you the opportunity to kind of learn and see what an iSearch paper can be. And I'm going to do it in an oral format. The ultimate goal is that I wanted to be the best teacher I could be. And I'm going to share with you how that happened and the process it took to get there. So my thesis statement could be, what are the characteristics of a high quality educator? And then I would do research on that. And then in my iSearch, I would start with my story first. That's what you're going to get now, is the story. So we're going to start with some music really quick. Let me see if I can find that song and we'll get into my story now.
Es mi orgullo haber nacido en el barrio más humilde.
El grito. Oh man, do I get the power and the energy and the lift that I need when I do that. El grito means something very special to me. And let me first start by sharing my full name, which is Rudy Jimenez Ortiz. And the Jimenez comes from my mom's maiden name. And there I am just months old with my mom, Julia Jimenez Ortiz, and with my dad, Ruben Ortiz. What you don't know in this story is what happened about a year and a half before this picture. My parents tragically lost my older brother in a car accident. He was with the babysitter. A semi-truck crashed into the car, and my parents lost my brother. They went through a very difficult time, a time that almost led them to getting a divorce. And then they got pregnant with me. And I kind of knew, being born as this family, that I was the glue. I really firmly believe that it wasn't for me, my parents wouldn't have stayed together. But I was the glue that kept my parents together. They put all their energy into me. My mom, she was my best friend, a person that I could tell anything, everything about, was always there for me, was always my champion, was always supporting me, motivating me, giving me life lessons. But at the end of the day, person I could just talk to, person who I loved, respected so much because of her actions, because of what she did. My mom was amazing, though. You could have heard her listening to cumbias like this right here.
Esto es para ti, mamita.
Or listen to 80s music.
Ah.
and her favorite, Motown. My mom gave me the love of music. She was a beautiful singer. Actually, in high school, she had her own band, Julia and the Black Knights, and actually had a record deal to go to San Diego, record an album, but my grandpa wouldn't let her. but my mom was rock solid. Not to say that my dad was a bad dad. No, I'm not saying that at all. But my dad was in the military, was gone a lot. And so my mom was that person that was just always that rock, that foundation, always there for me, always supporting me. And just a beautiful human being that I'm so fortunate and lucky to have in my life. I remember my first day of preschool. And at that time, my grandparents, which you'll see right here, Aurelio Jimenez and Blanca Jimenez, these are the parents of my mom right here. They lived in Calexico, California, which is like our San Luis, about an hour away on the California side, west of us. That's their border region. My grandparents lived on 2nd Street. Their fence, their backyard fence, was the international border. I would hit a home run with the T-ball bat, and my ball would land in another country. And I loved Calexico, California. It was an amazing place to be. But my grandparents, they were migrant workers. They would, during the summer months, before I was born, when mom was little, they would go to Gilroy, Salinas, those areas, and work out there. And then come back to the Imperial Valley and work there. And then during times too, my grandpa got into construction and helping building homes and offices and different things. Like that. But my grandpa, another person I was very fortunate and lucky to have in my life, I called him Maunchy. That was his nickname. And he would wake up in the summertime when he was living with us, when he was retired already, and they'd come stay with us in San Diego, where I was born and raised, and wake up like at 4:30, 5 in the morning. And when he would wake up, he would scream this big grito like I did. And there I was in summer vacation, and I would wake up and I would hear him. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what's so early? I don't have to go to school. He's waking me up. But it was a beautiful opportunity for me to go in the kitchen. He would be making his coffee, have his pan dulce, his sweet bread. And we would just talk and have conversations. And he would give me stories of how it was when he was growing up, the poverty he lived in. More importantly, he would give me corridos, these historical stories and song formation to connect with my roots and who I am. And he never wanted me to forget where I came from. But he always told me that I could be that one that would transform our family, that I would have the ability to go to college. And he made college real for me. And the way my family made college real for me is that after my first day of preschool, I went to Head Start preschool. And that story is kind of funny because I remember my first day getting on the bus, coming home back on the bus, I fell asleep. They forgot to drop me off because I fell asleep and they couldn't see me. And I woke up back in the school bus lot, and the bus driver, never forget her face of like, oh my goodness, I forgot you. She had red curly hair. And oh my goodness, we got to take you back to her mom. My mom was freaking out, trying to follow the bus, got me back home. But when we got back home and that story was done, we went to the bank. And my parents put in some money with my grandparents, put some money in. Wasn't a lot. I think it was like $25, something like that, to start my college savings. Because my family wanted to ensure that from day one, their actions would motivate and support me to not have to use my hands to work in the fields to support my family. That through a college education, I could change the outcomes for our family. Those were good days. You have my mom's baby sister, Veronica, I call her Ronnie, who's a special needs preschool teacher in Napa. My uncle Aggie, who worked for Caltrans for many, many years, now retired. My Nina, my mom's oldest sister, who was an elementary teacher in the Imperial Valley. All my cousins here, and actually Chris, just about 8 months ago, we went to his wedding up in Julian, California. And there I am. I think I was about a junior in high school when we celebrated my grandparents' 50th wedding anniversary. My grandma, oh my gosh, the best hugs, the love, always positive, always looking at the positiveness of and life. The best cook in the world. I miss her food, and just spoiled the heck out of me. And these two individuals really became my rock and my foundation. And I was so very fortunate to have them live with us during those summer months. But it really was my grandpa giving me those stories, giving me the ability to connect and to learn from him, that was really key, in my upbringing. You know, what's interesting is growing up, I didn't like school that much. I wasn't a big fan of school. When I was in elementary school, one of the things I loved about school is that I was in a break dancing crew. I was into break dancing and enjoyed my time of been locking and having fun. And we had a crew. We were called H2O because we would flow like water. And so a lot of fun, was into break dancing, really had a lot of good fun during those times. And it was a way for me to express myself, let go. And it was actually break dancing, going to the break dancing club after school that made me want to go to school. And so here's a little song that I remember back in those days. It was at this time that I was into breakdancing that my family and I decided to move from an area called City Heights, the area I was born in, San Diego, went to Euclid Elementary, and then went to Greg Rogers Elementary that was in Chula Vista. And I'll never forget this when my mom had my back, is that there was a Christmas talent show. And I wanted to put breakdancing on. There was no breakdance crew in that area. They really weren't introduced to that. And actually, that community thought it was gang related. And I want to show them, like, it's not gang related. And they were not going to let me perform because it was gang related to their perspective. And so my mom went to the school, talked to the principal, really showed with them that it wasn't gang related. And the way I was able to breakdance and perform at a talent show was that I had a breakdance to Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Of our music teacher playing it on the piano. And that's how I was able to break dance. My mom talked about, like, hey, that's okay. This is the way you can introduce people to your art, to your form, and just always sticking up for me and being there. And that it's not the perfect way that you want to do it, but it's the way you can do it now to get them to understand this is not gang related. So my mom has always had these like tokens of knowledge. But through her action and supporting me. In middle school, I went through a really hard time. We'll go back to this picture. My uncle Richard there, another guy who I love so much and always been there, he had a daughter that was about 2 years older than me, Nancy. And Nancy lost the battle to cancer. And that was really hard on me to have a cousin that had a tight, close relationship with that I love so much to see her go through that process and to lose her. Went through a really time that I looked back and it was like depression. I was questioning like how do kids get sick? Why do we allow this to happen? Why couldn't we save her? And it just really bugged me and just couldn't believe that she was no longer with us. And school was not my best friend. I played sports in school. It kept me going there. But a year later, my Uncle Richard gets in a car accident and becomes paralyzed from the waist down, actually on the actual day that my cousin passed away. So our family went through a lot, but our family stuck together. And I remember going to LA on the weekends to visit my uncle, watch him go through physical therapy, be there with him, but also see how positive he was. He was going through hell, going through a lot. But I just remember the power of him saying, I'm alive and I get to wake up and breathe. I'm going to fight this and I'm going to go through this and I have my family. And I just remember, like, how are you so positive of losing my cousin, being in this car accident? So then I had like no excuse to not be positive myself. And he really gave me that power. And I remember in middle school, we had this college night, and it was the last day, one of your last weeks in middle school. And I met with my counselor, Mr. Starr, with my parents, and they were going to set up your high school plan to get you to the next level. And Mr. Starr, a friend of my parents, told my parents that I was not college material, that they were not going to set me up for that kind of rigor of work because they didn't think I could handle it. And I was so embarrassed, because you have to remember that my family had been saving money for me to go to college. My birthdays, they put money in there. They would put money in that savings, my grandparents. And so I had this money that was there that I felt, well, I'm never going to use it. And I just felt so ashamed and sad. And like I had let them down. I remember going home and crying. My mom and dad came into my room and said, you have two options here. A, you believe what he thinks, and that's what you are. Or number two, you do everything in your power to prove him wrong. Because we know that you can do that. And I was so fortunate and lucky to have my grandparents, my aunts and uncles, and my parents that never let me give up, that always had my back. They were always there for me, always supportive. High school started. So I wasn't on that track initially to take AP advanced placement or honor classes. I played basketball, was a pretty good basketball player, loved basketball, big Lakers fan. It was the time of Magic Johnson, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Showtime, big soccer player, loved playing soccer. And I had a good friend who played soccer that started playing tennis. And he said, hey, my grandma's paying for tennis lessons. Would you come and play with me? And I was like, tennis? I knew nothing about tennis. I didn't own a tennis racket or anything. But my junior year with my friend, we started playing tennis. And tennis kind of changed my life. See, the high school I went to, Hilltop High School, had a pretty good tennis team. Started picking up my junior year, like I said. But the coach of our team started to see my leadership skills and see how I was motivating other players, how I was trying to do the best to become the best player I could be. And I really enjoyed the game. I loved the one-on-one. I loved that there was no excuses, that if I failed, it was on me, and I had to learn of ways to improve my game. And it became my life. Everything I wanted to do was to play tennis, and never thought that would have been. And my coach was like, Rudy, like, you're smart. You're getting some good grades here. You're a leader. Like, why aren't you taking AP and honor classes? And I was lucky. My coach, Mr. Hunt, his wife was a counselor at our school. Set up a meeting with her. And then towards my junior year and senior year, they put me in AP classes, honor classes to get me to be college bound. So tennis did more than just give me an outlet to do athletics and have fun. But with the connections and the relationships that I've made there through my coach and my friends, and all my friends on the tennis team were always talking about college and the next step, and it really inspired me as well. Gave me the connections and the relationships to make that college dream a reality again. My senior year, I was one of the top players in all of San Diego, and had different colleges looking at me for scholarships. Had an opportunity to go to Point Loma Nazarene University, had opportunities to go to Minnesota, up in LA to play. And at the end of the day, the local community college coach came up and said, hey, you can play here. We'll give you a full ride. And that's what I did. I went to Southwestern Community College, a community college just like AWC out there in San Diego. So I was once in the same state that you're in as a community college student. And I did 2 years playing tennis at the community college, enjoyed it, had a lot of fun. But my mom was a preschool teacher. She got a lot of accolades. She got Teacher of the Year, Lakeshore Teacher of the Year. And what I didn't tell you is that during high school and college, I turned my break dancing into DJing. And I became a DJ, would do quinceañeras, house parties, and a lot of things like that. And here's some of the songs that were big at my time. One more for you.
Un americano que no sepa hablar español.
This was like one of my favorite DJs, DJ Laz, who connected Latin flavors with hip hop. So DJing became an outlet for me. Man, I gotta say, I was racking in a lot of good money because there was a quinceañera every weekend. You do one person's quinceañera and they have a cousin's that have a quinceañera like in a year. So you were setting things up and it was a lot of fun. But during the off-season of tennis, I was looking for like a full-time job, just not a weekend job. And my mom goes, "Hey, we're looking for more teacher assistants in our preschools." Took the test. I'll be very honest with you, got the job because of my mom. My mom knew the directors, the principals, and oh, this is Julia's son, so he must be good. And I never wanted to let my mom down, so I took it very serious. And that's when everything changed for me. My passion changed from tennis to teaching. When I got my first hands of working with children, I said, "Man, this is the job I want to do." My mom was like, "No, I don't want you to go to college to be a teacher." But I loved it, and she knew it was a passion of mine. She knew I had it, so she allowed me to really fulfill that journey and take off in that journey. I then went to Cal State University, San Marcos, and at that point, they had a program that if you were a teacher's assistant going to school there, they would pay off all your school debt if you chose to be a teacher at a low performing school. So I thought, great. My associates paid for it through tennis. Tennis is a great hobby. It's awesome. I love it. But this is my real passion is teaching. And I saw myself first being a high school teacher, like a history teacher, and then being like a tennis coach. And really supporting my children to be successful, my students to be successful. And that's what I thought my dream would be. Went to Cal State San Marcos, and it was a newer university in California at the time. I was able to, with other students, to start their future teachers club. And that led me into the Student California Teachers Association, the statewide association for future teachers. I became the statewide vice president and then president for that organization. And as president, I would go to national meetings in Washington, D.C., and also in L.A. And so I was getting this great education. I was hanging out with educational leadership in D.C. and L.A. and just saw this kind of just passion grow and started to build my network and my relationships of those that are already in the field of education. Graduated from college and had the opportunity to work as a middle school teacher, did that. But there was this organization called First Five California. And it was this initiative that got passed in California to help support. One of their goals was to build more preschools in the state. And that teacher that I used to work for as an aide was a director at the time and said, "Hey, we're opening up these preschools. I saw you just graduated. We'd love for you to teach." And I did that. I taught preschool and I saw the list of schools. I saw that Euclid Elementary was there. So that school that I was a break dancer for, I got to teach at Euclid Elementary. And that was amazing. And that was a dream come true for me. And what I'm about to show you right now is a video of my time of being at Euclid Elementary. And so I hope you get to enjoy this video as you get to see me in action as a preschool teacher at a school that I was once a student at.
you to give me and him a round of applause for Mr. Rudy Ortiz, who has been selected by the district as the elementary school teacher of the year. Mr. Ortiz, come on up here.
I didn't believe it. It was very overwhelming. I remember when Ms. Jacobs had told me that she announced I had won. I was still asking her the whole thing for reals, when I was walking up, because it was just very overwhelming. And the support of the staff here was tremendous. And I think more importantly, for me, why I ran for District Teacher of the Year was to really do it for the whole team of teachers who was here at this school and represent them. And so to me, it was just a big gift that I could give the school and more importantly, the community of City Heights. And so all of these thoughts were just racing through my head. And when I was a student here, my first year teaching here, the students I have now, seeing the students that I had previously in years. So it was just hard to take it all in at once. Well, I come from a history of teachers. My mom was a teacher, just retired. She put over 20 years in the district. My aunts are teachers in different districts. And ever since I was little, I used to love helping people and helping students. And I remember being in sixth grade, I would help the third graders during my lunchtime. And I remember in high school doing a cross-age tutoring where I would go read to some of the students. And at that moment, I learned I had a gift. So my goal, I thought I was gonna be a middle school or high school teacher. And so I started to work as a substitute, as an aide in the middle schools and high schools, and found out that a lot of the low-performing students didn't get some foundations in earlier years. Went down to second, kindergarten, and eventually ended up in preschool, where I thought I could make the most impact.
Let's look around and see. Okay, let's look around.
So really quick, if you look at this classroom, one of the things I want to point out was all these children were living in poverty. They qualified for our state preschool. But number two, I had six different languages in that classroom: English, Spanish, Vietnamese, Tagalog, Oromo, and Swahili. So it was a beautiful opportunity to set these children up for ultimate success. These kids that you see here, 87% of them went on by third grade to be in honors classes. These children that did not speak English when they started with me went on to honors by third grade. Out of that 87%, 80% of them by middle school were in a college prep class course school called Royce Middle School through UCSD. So by middle school, they were already college bound. I started to understand the power of the first 5 years, brain development, child development, and how to take advantage of that. And during this time, I was working on my master's to be the best teacher I could be, to get my master's in the art of teaching, to learn the best philosophies and the best methods to support achievement and success, not only just for my students, but also for their families. You know, get a little bit more of that in the rest of the video.
We're gonna see who's here. Who's that in the corner? Who's that? Is that Emmanuel?
Yeah.
You wanna say hi, Emmanuel?
Hi, Emmanuel.
Who's in front of him?
Aaron.
You want to say, hi, Aaron.
Hi, Aaron.
One of the teachers I used to work for told me there's an opening at Euclid. And when she told me that, I was like, I have to go. That needs to be my school. Something that was like meant to be. I had a feeling. I wasn't nervous when I came here. It was home to me. And so to come back and teach here is something that is simply, it's a book. I mean, it's something that you see in the movies and things like that. And more importantly, to live in the house again that I used to live in when I was little. And so that's amazing to me, is to have that house and have the students know that Mr. Ortiz is a teacher here, but also my neighbor.
I can smell food, yelled a voice from nearby. It's the bear, cried Eddie. Where can I hide?
Where can he go? Okay, I like the way Ayub is sitting down. Ayub, are you ready? Come here, Ayub, let's go in the basket. You ready? All right, so Ayub's in the basket.
You know what I've learned from my students is to enjoy it, especially the 3 and 4 year olds and some of them 5 years old. As we come here, I'm gonna make those 3 hours the most happy experience they're gonna have in their life for that day. And it's a short limited time that I have with them. And I make a strong commitment to always think about when I'm writing my lessons or when I'm writing for their week lessons,
sniffing
what's the
air.
Best I can buy for those 3 hours? What's the best I can get
a
out of them
teddy
to learn?
Bear's picnic
but most importantly,
hooray!
Be happy, but more
say
importantly,
help.
The foundation of this classroom is to have a high
Eddie
self-esteem.
Say,
and
he's
a lot of people don't realize
way.
But the importance of a happy childhood in those early years determines
this
a lot
what
of what
you
your
looks
later
like
adult
in there.
Years will be like.
He just has that, I can't describe it, it's just that energy he has when he teaches. He puts music to them and how he speaks to the kids, and I just love that out of him. And I think especially the music part, he brings in salsa, cumbias, African music, beats, everything he incorporates within the classroom, and that's what I really enjoyed learning from him.
I get to work with the families. Once they get older, the families kind of back away, you know? And every other Friday, the parents are invited to come in. And they're big events. We'll make books together, we'll do science projects. There's actually grass over there in the corner. We plant our seeds together. And it's become a time to not just learn together as far as academically, but the parents get to meet their neighbor. And so a lot of times we lead these busy lives, even though we live in this neighborhood, and it's been a really nice time to see these parents support each other. Oh, you need a babysitter? Sure, I can do it. And that's the joy I get out of preschool, is that if I can share that the importance my family had on my educational career, and they were my backbone, that if they do the same, that they can really get their students to be successful.
He knows kids all the way from pre-K to fifth grade, and they know Mr. Ortiz, and they know what a great guy he is. And he was the keynote speaker for our fifth grade promotion last year, and just did a super job of gearing up our fifth graders as they were leaving and motivating them to get out there and do whatever they want to do with their lives and setting goals for themselves to be and do whatever they can be. And he teaches that from pre-K on.
He makes us feel happy and like we can do anything we want to when we grow up.
He is one of the most incredible teachers I've seen.
He really loves what he does.
Oh, he's a really great teacher.
He has a very positive attitude.
He's just an awesome teacher.
So I share this with you. The reason why I share this with you is that before I got Teacher of the Year, I was the first preschool Teacher of the Year ever within the school district in the county. The first person to ever win it at Euclid Elementary School. And it was a big gift I can give the community that we at Euclid had the best. That we are fully invested in your children and believe that all of your children can succeed. And that's the message I provided. And also the importance of the first 5 years of life that we're going to get into in this class. What the video doesn't show is this. This was my third year teaching when I got the award. During my first year teaching, I remember watching on TV the San Diego County Teacher of the Year award show. It's a big event in San Diego. They have it on TV. And I remember writing down all the names of the people that won or that were nominated. Found out what school they were at, called them up, and had meetings with all of them. I wanted to learn what made them special, what made them different. And out of those people I met, two of them I still keep in contact with. I always wanted to put myself in the environment like my family gave me. Who can I learn from? How can I keep this network around me that motivates me, supports me, and helps me? And how funny then, 2 years later, after watching that, I was on that show. We need to take time to learn from others. Just not from books. How did you move from San Diego to Yuma? And that's what will kind of conclude the story. Finished up my master's, had the opportunity to meet my wife, you see right here, Leslie. She was a grad student in San Diego, was a substitute teacher, was finishing up my thesis statement and my master's. She's from the Imperial Valley, which is weird, the same area that my parents are from. And we fell in love. And at that time, she was looking for work as a school psychologist. We were engaged, and she applied for a job in Yuma. And I told her, go do it, get your feet wet, get the opportunity to interview. At the time, we were watching the movie Freedom Riders. Dr. Cohn, who's a superintendent in Long Beach, actually came to you to San Diego and was my superintendent. After I got Teacher of the Year, it totally changed my life. Took me out of the classroom. He made me a coach to learn what all the best curriculums were out there and methods of teaching, and I was to then be a trainer for our school district. I then became an administrator within our school district, one of the youngest administrators in our school district. Once again, I had Dr. Cohn, who was there supporting me and helping me and being a mentor. My wife was looking for work, or my fiance at the time, and she got a job here in Yuma. She aced that interview. So our first year of marriage, I was in San Diego. She was in Yuma. On the weekends, I would drive over to Yuma and started to like it out here. And we made a commitment. She, that house you saw in that video, we lived there in the summertime. And we said, whatever the first job you get in San Diego or I get in Yuma, that's where we're moving. And I became a quality first coach, a preschool coach here in Yuma, then a mental health consultant. Then I worked for ADE, and now my current position as the regional director for First Things First here in the Yuma region, supporting 11 council members to implement and provide around a $24 million budget in our region. I never would have thought, here I've been now 11 years in Yuma, that I'd be the happiest, love it, enjoy it, and I'll have the privilege and honor to work for AWC. I've been doing that now, what, gosh, 8 years. And here in my time at AWC, had the time to meet with professors that used to be here, like Judy Watkinson, who was a great early childhood professor who retired a few years ago, and kind of learned from her and had the opportunity to learn from her. Her and I are still friends. And the ultimate goal that I saw is that now in my role as a regional director, I don't get to teach anymore. But now with through AWC, I get to fulfill that filling of my cup of giving back and supporting new educators, social workers, just new leaders out here in Yuma. Within my second year teaching for AWC, I was nominated for Faculty of the Year. I couldn't win it because you had to be a faculty member for at least 3 years. And then when provided the opportunity again, I was Adjunct Faculty of the Year for AWC. But I attribute that to learning from others, taking the time to always be a student. I'm never going to stop being a student. So where my life is now as a father. I have twins who, this is the older picture. So you're at AWC, they've gone to the lab school, but they're 4, going on 5, and my oldest one who's in first grade. My three girls are my everything. And I want to give them what my family gave me, that solid rock, that foundation, the inspiration. Have them do hard work, but make them feel what success feels like when you put in that time and that hard work. We call Yuma home. We call AWC home because we love what this community has to offer. There's a lot of great leaders in this community, and so many leaders that I get to learn from every single day. And that's my challenge to you. Who's in your network? Who can you put in your network to support you, to enhance you, to motivate you, and also give back to as well? Your network is your net worth. And at this time in our age, we have the ability to pick who we put in our lives. What I want to do now is tell you that the magic of all this hard work of what makes the best teacher, the most exceptional teacher, boiled down to three things for me. You got to be a learner. You got to own the content. You got to own the art of teaching. That will come. Number two, you have to have high expectations. You got to believe that your students will succeed. And you got to lead by example, by showing them the habits and the hard work. And number three, you got to form positive, loving relationships. See, kids learn from those they love and those who they believe in. And how you take time to build relationships is by telling your story. There's power in story. So that's what we're going to do this week. This week, you're going to tell your story. So what you're going to do is go down to week one. And you have a discussion that you're going to do. Click on introductions. And it needs to be 300 words. This is a writing intensive class. You're going to talk about why you're taking this class, what your intended major is, and how you believe this course will help you with your career or personal goals. Post that by Friday. And then by Sunday, please respond with 100 words to two of your classmates. Okay. You do have a quiz this week. You're like, oh my gosh, this guy's already giving us a quiz. I can't believe it. Your quiz is this. There is in your course documents, you have what's called information sheet. I want you to download that, fill it out so I can get to know a little bit more about you. And then you're going to email that to me at my AWC email address, which you can find in our Canvas. So you're going to have to do your homework and find where you can email me, right? You must use your AWC email address too. I won't take any outside email address, okay? And then what you're going to do, this is your quiz for the week. You're going to email me that information sheet. Once you email it to me, you're going to say and answer, you're going to answer this question. Did you complete and email the information sheet located under the course document tab? You say true, boom, submit it, and you get your 10 points. 5 points for your discussion, 10 points for this. We should all be getting 15 points this week. It is my privilege and honor to serve you this semester. And I'm looking forward to a great semester. These videos are going to be here to support your learning during your online learning time. I have three suggestions for you. A, for this week, read chapter one to be ready for next week. We'll start with chapter one. Number two, start looking at the observations and which one you want to complete. And number three, start thinking about what you want to learn more about, and that can become your iSearch paper. Go through the whole book, see all the sections and the topics and themes, and maybe there's something there that you want to learn more about, get deeper into. This semester, we go through like a chapter a week, even sometimes two chapters a week. So this gives you the opportunity to choose what you want to learn about. I want to thank all of you for showing up and for showing up for the rest of this semester. And number two, the ultimate goal of this class is this: to create a class that has the power to change your life. Yes, I said that. I firmly believe that this class can change your life and also the life of the children that you currently have or you will have in your life. The goal is this: to give you the information and real tools to help children meet their full potential, be ready for school, and set for life. For us to provide that for others, we must first provide that to ourselves. I wish all of you a wonderful semester and look forward to learning more about you this week. Have a wonderful day and take care. Bye-bye.